prop.
Let's go flying!
Recently, a bunch of powered paragliding tragics got together at a private property near the small country town of Tansey in southeast Queensland. These types of events are sadly few and far between, particularly in Queensland, so when the event was announced, I was definitely keen to make up the numbers. I'd been to some really good fly-ins over the years and they're always a blast. Unfortunately though, there aren't a lot of them here in Australia due to the vast distances pilots need to travel to get to them. There are many reasons pilots show up to these gatherings, and it's not only for the flying. They're a great way to meet new people and check out different gear and to surround yourself with like-minded people that share the same passion for flight that you do. Powered paraglider pilots aren't too fond of rough air. They typically like smooth air, so fly-ins need to be held at locations that provide good flying conditions for the attendees. Fortunately for those that did show up, we had three fantastic days of flying conditions. I'm yet to attend a PPG fly-in that I haven't thoroughly enjoyed, and so it was the case again for this event, which was aptly named the Paramotor Party Weekend. The event was held about 100 kilometres west of Gympie, which is on the northwestern end of the Sunshine Coast. For reference, it's about 2 hours or so north of Bris Vegas. The area is a rural agricultural area with a mixture of crop and cattle farming. The surrounding topography lends itself to some enjoyable terrain to fly over, with plenty of rolling hills and open country to explore. There aren't really any serious mountains in the area, so it was a good location to hold the event. The whole region doesn't get a lot of rainfall either, so things looked a tad dry and brown looking down from the air chair. But needless to say, there was still some great places to check out. Paramotor fly-ins are only partly about the flying anyway. It's the people that attend them that make these types of gatherings so enjoyable. In its first year, the event was held at the family farm of one of the pilots, Donuts. His real name is actually Paul, or Paulie, but we really only refer to him by his nickname. It's so much funnier. His family runs a few head of cattle and horses on the farm, and in the end, it proved to be a fantastic location. A lot of hard work and expense goes into organising and hosting fly-ins, so for Donuts and his family to arrange it all and provide comfortable facilities, including a portable dunny, hot showers and everything we needed for all that attended, was a major effort. The type of aircraft we fly requires stable air, so for these types of events to be successful, there is a heavy reliance on Mother Nature coming to the party, and luckily for us, that's exactly what she did. Flying conditions were ideal, with up to 3 hours of flyable air in the morning, with another couple hours in the afternoon, so we jagged a good one on the weather front, that's for sure. Each day followed a similar pattern. The mornings were cold, with temperatures in the low digits, which made for ideal flying conditions. Significant shrinkage, let me tell you. Things heated up as the sun ascended and the thermal activity increased through the middle of the day before it all settled closer to sunset, so we could go up again. As the sun buggered off each day and the nighttime rolled on, I'll tell you what, it got bloody cold, which gave us a great excuse to gather around the open fire and tell lies about how good we were as pilots, or to hang shit on those that may have blown a launch or stuffed up a landing. If you do attend a paramotor fly-in, don't bother setting an alarm or dream of sleeping in. You got no chance. In the search for smooth air, pilots will get up at ridiculous hours to be in the air as the sun comes up. Nothing like a screaming two-stroke to wake you up from a deep slumber on a frigid cold morning. The reward for this lunacy, though, was early fog and very low wind, which were the type of flying conditions paramotor pilots froth over.
We'll be right back.
The launch paddock was plenty big enough with a gentle downhill run for takeoff, which made it that much easier. There were a few trees around the edge of the paddock, but in general, it proved to be a fantastic launch area with ample room for everyone to set up and lay out their wings. One thing that I did notice was the growing number of pilots choosing to launch and fly with wheels. The number of foot launch versus the sit down and squeeze the throttle brigade was about 50-50 would be my best guess. Obviously, wheels allow those that may not be able to launch on their feet because they're too old, they're too slow, or they've got a dodgy knee, or because they're a fat heap fond of KFC, the opportunity to take up the sport. So it was fantastic to see those pilots attend and have a really great time. In particular, I thought it was very impressive to see Jan Smith, somewhere north of 70, strapped in and chasing the flying dream. The previous evening, she'd actually rolled the trike attempting to launch, which I happened to capture flying over the launch field. But there she was the next day, back out there again, having another crack. How good was that? One of the things that I do enjoy about going to events like this, besides the flying, is the opportunity to film some of the action from the ground. It's super interesting to see the varying techniques pilots use to take to the air. I have noticed over the last few years, though, that there is less and less drama or issues with pilots blowing launches or breaking equipment. Nowadays, gear is getting lighter and wings are designed to be easier to launch, which is helping to reduce the spills and frills my camera would have liked to capture. Most pilots launched well, buzzed around and came back with no worries at all. There was also an unfounded rumour I may have blown a launch or three, but I can't confirm that, so we'll move on, shall we? From a safety perspective, it was encouraging to see pilots starting motors either on their backs or bums on seats in trikes. It's always something we need to be very careful of in the sport for obvious reasons. Some of the flying suits that pilots chose to wear were a little bit interesting. Colin Gibson, always one to stand out from the crowd, took the prize for the most outrageous flight suit. Donuts thought he was looking pretty stylish, rolling around on his homemade trike, wearing the latest, greatest 2023 ski gear from Aldi, fine supplier of garments. Of course, as the host, he was entitled to look as silly as he wanted, I guess, so you look magnificent, my friend. One thing both the wheelies and the foot launch crew had in common was the fact that it took commitment to launch a powered paraglider, and watching it all in super slow motion, you really could see the effort required to launch and take to the sky by all concerned. The launch site did get busy at times, but in general, there was plenty of room for everyone to set up, go out flying, come back and land without affecting anyone that was set and ready to take off. In fact, I thought the flying etiquette of the whole event was very good from all pilots concerned, so well done to everyone.